Welcome, everyone, to another wonderful installment of Hidden Variables, the podcast where we explore and discover so many interesting people, discoveries, technologies, and topics. Today's guest is someone I am so privileged and honored to have. His name is Earl Grey. Don't know if he wants me to say his last name or not.
Yeah, sure. I usually addend my you know, my Grey with Anderson. Yeah. That is my actual last name. So
Earl Grey Anderson. But we go by Earl Grey because it's just uber cool. But a little bit about dear Earl. He is MUFON State Director of Southern California. He's a STAR team member and an executive member of MUFON's ERT, or the Experiencer Resource Team. Earl has hosted MUFON's Experiencer workshops at the last two MUFON Symposia, and will be hosting three different events at the upcoming 2024 MUFON Symposium in Dallas-Fort Worth, Texas, which is so exciting. Earl has personally investigated over 1,000 UFO reports and specializes in experiencer and high strangeness cases. He has appeared on multiple radio shows, podcasts, and TV shows such as the Travel Channel's Storming Area 51 special, which is awesome, the season finale of Motor Trend Television's Motor Mythbusters, Cars vs. UFOs, and will be featured host on the upcoming series, The Alien Disclosure Files. Earl has was featured in three documentaries that were released this year, all produced by the award-winning independent filmmaker Jeremy Nori, MUFON and UFOs, as well as the sequel, I Want to Believe, now available to watch on Tubi and various other streaming services. Earl recently represented MUFON's Experiencer Resource Team and shared about his own anomalous experience on two different episodes of the History Channel's flagship show, Ancient Aliens. Earl was a featured keynote speaker at Oregon's 2023 Manaman's UFO Fest. I never can say that. It's a mouthful. Sharing the stage with Travis Walton, Jennifer Stein, Sev Talk, and Cheryl and Linda Costa. Earl teaches an accredited course in ufology, UFOs, and other worlds at Los Angeles's Ellis College of Art and Design. That in itself is incredible. Just to say those words in our time, there is actually a college course that is accredited on UFOs. Amazing. A native of Southern California, Earl is also known as a published singer, songwriter, guitarist with three CDs under his belt. Earl Grey Anderson is currently writing his first book, The Grey Files, which will be published in mid-2024. And I can't wait. Earl dotes on his three children and three grandchildren and lives happily in Los Angeles with his wife, Lisa, and his cat, Thor, who you may see an appearance of here anytime. Let's talk about your leadership role at MUFON, your role as an executive member in MUFON's ERT, Experience Resource Team, and anything else your little heart desires or big heart desires. My dear Earl Grey, welcome to Hidden Variables.
Thank you, Debs. My goodness, you read the whole litany there.
Well, I tried to memorize it, but it's a lot. So
No, I can't do that either. So I'm busy. We'll just put it that way. And it's good busy. It's living my deepest, most hopeful dreams. And there you go. So life is beautiful. It's good. And it's good to be alive on planet Earth right now. It's such an exciting time. You know, it's a catalytic time. Things are changing. People are changing, you know, and I think that our century that we're living in is going to be definitive, seen as possibly even a new wave of evolutionary development for the human race if we, you know, follow our good angels, our good instincts.
Yeah, I agree.
That's what I'm all about, is letting people know that we have the choice, you know, to be afraid, to be confused, to be divisive out there, or to be positive and good, you know, good vibrations. That's right. I mean, there you go. And living in Southern California and getting to such an honor to be representing this great organization, MUFON, the oldest, most venerated UFO investigatory group in the world, is never lost on me. It's a blessing and a joy, and that's my life.
You're the man for the job, because you're such a great researcher, such a great resource. You're an academic. You're really a Renaissance man, I think, but you also have a heart. And I think that's the most important thing right now. I mean, for the viewers who don't know, I channel a lot, but the main group entity that I channel are called the teachers, or the star teachers. And they say this particular incarnation that we are living in, that we're focused on right now, is the one where the human species makes the jump to the next level. Wow. And we leave behind some of these, or most of the heaviness of the past, and we join the cosmic community, basically, as freshmen. But at least we make the jump. But but they say what we're doing right now is what causes it. And they also say you don't do it, you have done it. We're just trying to bring you into focus of what you've done. So I agree with you. This is the pivotal moment, and you are the pivotal person to be kind of the MC for all of it to come through. I think you're wonderful.
Thank you.
You have such an enormous body of work, and you are busier now than you ever have been after you've retired, which is also my case. It's bizarre. I've always led a busy life, but once I retired from corporate world, boom, here we have all of this. Mm. So the floor is yours. You and I have talked ad nauseum a lot about things. I just adore you. But I think people would love to know a little bit about how did this begin in your life first, and how did it blossom into what it is now?
I'd love to talk about that. I'm honored to, and thank you for the kind preamble that you gave me. Oh, hope I can live up to that. For myself, this has been a lifelong adventure. I feel like there's been a hand other than my own in where I am and what I'm doing now. But I do believe that my whole life led up to what I'm doing right now. At one time, for many years, I worked as a nurse, a hands-on nurse, which was important to me. That's, I guess that somewhere within me there's this caregiver thing, but I many years as a musician and a songwriter, I sort of beat my head against the wall of the music industry that is focused here, New York, London, and Nashville, Tennessee. There's kind of four places. Mm-hmm. Austin, Texas has kind of become a little hub too. Yeah. But very competitive out there. I kind of thought that was what my whole life was leading up to. And it all diverted. It all became E.T., which is so strange. But looking now in retrospect to everything, some of my very earliest memories. Now, my mother is probably a lot of people out there watching this know, because the story's kind of out there now. My mom worked as a secretary for Howard Hughes, the millionaire. She worked at Hughes Aircraft in Los Angeles back in the 1950s. And I'll give you one little thing before I go further into my mom's story. One of my earliest memories is when I was 3 years old, climbing up the swing set that my dad built out of wood that was in our backyard. We had monkey bars. Mm-hmm. And I went up there, and it was just the most important thing in the world, a little three-year-old climbing all the way at the top. You couldn't get away with that nowadays.
Oh, gosh, no.
No. But I was up there waving and singing at the sky. And my mom opens up the kitchen window. It's like, who are you waving and singing to, Earl? And without hesitation, I was able to answer her. I said, I'm waving and singing to the space people, Mom. It's the space people. Oh my gosh. And this took my mother aback a little bit, but I think it was 2 years later where I was 5 years old at this point, and we were sitting down for breakfast. I was going to go to kindergarten that day. And my mom told me this strange story about how, well, we all knew that she worked for Hughes, right? She had mm-hmm. that background. It was no, that was no secret, right? Everybody knew about that in our family. But she said, son, what you don't know is that my job was very, very strange. And she just kind of went and started telling me this story. She said, you know, that they sent me out once with a, you know, couple of security guys in the middle of nowhere. And that was the words that she used, middle of nowhere. She said, it was the desert, the great American desert. And they took me out to what looked like a little concrete shack or a bunker. And I was confused. She said, I felt confused. Were they going to show me a tractor or farm equipment or what, yeah. what do you keep in a, you know, in the middle of nowhere in a locked up concrete shack? But they apparently opened this thing up and there was one object in this room. It was plain walls, everything, except there was an elevator. And she said, an elevator like you would see in any large building, you know, skyscraper, what have you, except that this elevator obviously didn't go up. There was no up there available.
Straight down.
So she got into this thing and she thought that perhaps it would go down a floor or two. And she said, I started getting scared because the elevator was really fast. I could feel butterflies in my stomach. That's what she said. And she said, and it just kept going. They didn't give her any idea of what to expect or even where they were taking her. It was one of those trips that they would send her out on. Yeah. So she said that the doors of this thing opened up and there was a little city under the desert. She called it that. She said it was a little city under the desert. And that's how she referred to it, you know, the few times after this in my life when she'd bring it up. It was always the little city. She said that they got around in golf carts, mm-hmm. that they had a bowling alley, they had a barber shop, but the barber shop knew how to do my hair, is what she said. So this tells me she was there for a while. You don't have to have your hair permed, bobbed or whatever she was having done down
every
there.
Every few months.
Yes. And she said that they had cafes and they just tried to make people feel at home there because they were there for long, long periods of time. And it was a mile under the desert, is what she said. Very words, mile under the desert.
Can you just imagine?
Yeah. She said she kind of wrapped up her talk by saying that, you know, she worked with a lot of scientists and rocket scientists. And she said, and by the way, son, I know that you're very, very interested in outer space and space people. And she said, I just want you to know that UFOs are real, that we already know we're not alone in the universe, that there intelligent life in the universe is a very real thing. It's not a question. We already know. Now it's time for school. Get your lunch.
Oh my God.
You know, kiss your mom, you know.
Mom. Oh.
Yeah. So this was my origin point or the flash point of what you're seeing now.
Catalyst.
Through the years, my mom would bring up, you know, she usually didn't talk about it. But in 5 years after she gave me her little disclosure talk. I was living in Thousand Oaks, California. I was in fourth grade. Every Friday we would have a show and tell thing where, and the teacher would give you an assignment of what to talk about. So it was, what do your parents do? What is, and most of the moms at this point, you know, were still housewives and stuff. Sure. We're talking, you know, 1968.
Yeah.
Roughly. But so I talked about my dad's landscaping business and people were, you know, yawning and you know, talking amongst themselves. So being, I guess, the dramatic person that I am, I said, but let me tell you about my mother. And I pretty much reiterated everything that my mom had said to me at that kitchen table to the 30 kids or so that were in our class and the teacher, right? I started getting teased at school, as you might imagine. They would do like the little antennae and my favorite Martian.
Yeah, you know, just coming out, yeah.
And that ridicule kind of followed me. It followed me up into when I became a musician in high school. It calmed down, you know, because mm-hmm. people think musicians are cool for some reason. I don't know why.
No, I'm but very
it was the same old nerd, but had a guitar around my neck. The teacher called my mom in for a parent-teacher conference. It wasn't conference time. The other kids weren't having their parents out. And I started thinking, I'm in trouble maybe.
Yeah,
I didn't know. I didn't know what it was about. And I wasn't really thinking about the whole UFO lecture I gave in fourth grade, you know. But my mom came out and I was playing on the monkey bars there at school, probably waving and singing to the space people, you know. So my mom comes back out. She's kind of, I don't know, had a dour expression, not happy. We got into the car and I'm really thinking, I got to be in trouble. What did I do? Mom turns around to me and she says, son, I'm not mad at you. You didn't know that anything that you were doing was wrong. I never told you you couldn't talk about these things. And she's trying to drive, right? We're just about a mile away from school. Well, in far distance, but she's having trouble driving and talking. She looks back at me again and she says, my God, you were just a baby. How did you remember this? You know? And she said, son, you can't ever talk about UFOs or intelligent life in outer space to anybody ever, ever again. She said, when I told you that, I thought you were so young that you would forget. And it seemed like you were a safe person I could tell this to. She said, I didn't lie to you, and it is true, but people don't know about little cities under the desert, and they certainly don't know about, you know, intelligent life visiting Earth. They're not telling people, and I signed papers that said I wouldn't talk about this. She said, son, your mother could go to prison if you talk about this.
Oh, my
gosh. I know. And, you know, I just remember just feeling kind of dazed while she's driving home. Once we got home, that was kind of it. She didn't keep talking about it. That was all she wrote until about 1977. I took her to see the film Star Wars. Now, my mom kept getting repeated cancers. And we hear about this. I've talked with Richard Souter about this, who's written quite a few books about our military dumbs, deep underground military bases. It's a thing. They're profligate across our country. Other nations do the same thing. It's how you hide stuff.
It is.
How you keep things secret from your enemies and the public, in this case. But he said that many of the people that worked in the early dumbs had repeated cancers. Now, he wasn't sure what the cause of this was. They seemed to build them in the desert near the Trinity site and places where we were doing nuclear explosions and testing and stuff. Mm-hmm. Perhaps it was downrange of that, and this is what caused it. Maybe they were using a nuclear pile for energy. I mean, you have to figure you have a little city under the desert. It's going to be off the grid. Absolutely. They're powering it somehow.
Right.
Maybe they didn't know how to protect people properly from that sort of thing back then.
And they didn't know much. I mean, they didn't know anything really about other than Half-Life.
No. I mean, John Wayne died from, I mean, he was in the Genghis Khan film that they filmed in that same area.
Right there. I know.
Everybody there got cancers that, you know, ultimately took their lives. But mom, she had a doctor's appointment with her oncologist, and I went with her. I was 19 years old. I was being her support system. I loved my mom. I mean, my mom and I, there was just some connection. Maybe it was this outer space thing. I don't know, but
just a soul connection too.
Mm-hmm. But she got a clean bill of health. Her doctor's office was near where the old Hughes office was. It was that area, Santa Monica, California. Mm-hmm. She seemed to be in a good mood. I was happy that she was okay. Because she'd had a couple of incidents where, you know, she'd had cancer almost take her life already. And she must have been 40, in her mid-40s to late-40s at this point. So I was 19. So we went to see the movie Star Wars. We had lunch and saw a movie. It looked interesting. When the curtains closed, my mom started talking. She became very voluble, which she usually didn't do. Usually, you know, she would say some little comment and that would be it, you know, because you could tell she felt guilty talking about the stuff she wasn't supposed to talk about.
Sure.
And she was also at this point working as a headhunter for the aerospace groups, mm-hmm. that read kind of like a litany of David Grush's.
Wow.
People that have materials that aren't giving them up, right?
Wow.
You know, Lockheed, TRW, Northrop, et cetera, et cetera. Those were her clients. So the curtains closed, the movie was over, and my mom starts talking. She said, "Son, you have no idea how close to the truth that film is, Star Wars." She said, "All the different beings, the different spacecraft, all of that." She said, "It's really, really like that. But they're never going to tell the public. They'll never tell the public, son." And at age 19, I was old enough to be a little rascally. And I, why the hell not? This is important. This don't people deserve to know that we're not alone in the universe? That's like, is there a God? Is, you know, what happens when you die? And are we alone in the universe? You know, it's one of the, you know, the little trifecta of questions that are on, you know, people's minds. It's important, I think, for development for us as an intelligence ourselves. She brought up what you usually hear from officials and people in the know. She said, "Well, they're afraid of how people will react, son." She brought up the War of the Worlds radio broadcast where people barricaded themselves in their, you know, basements.
Right. Went nuts.
They went nuts, more or less, on a small scale.
Yeah.
But that was the excuse that I think they gave my mom. It sounded to me like she was just repeating something that she was told.
Right.
She mentioned world religions, that it might harm them. She mentioned the way the power structure, fiscally in the world is, that it could disrupt things. And that was kind of it. She said, "It's real. It's realer than you will ever know." And that was the end of the conversation. And that last sentence kind of ate at me over the years. It's realer than you will ever know. And it's like, well, I'm not accepting that. I think that I have the right and the need to know. And this is what led to me eventually becoming a field investigator, joining MUFON, putting everything else, shoving it to the side more or less, and making this my number one. It became my obsession, like it does for so many of us, because it's important. It's important, and it's personal.
It is personal.
Yeah,
it is personal.
Long answer to a short question.
No, I love it.
Next.
And, you know, I doubt there are many people watching this who aren't familiar with you, but the ones who aren't need that background, because it's so special and so important. And it's funny because in the work that I do and in my whole life, what I found is almost to a person, the ones who are the most involved and the most active and the most prolific with the work that they're doing had that, I call it the clarion call. They had a clarion call at some point back in their childhood, or, you know, in their teens or maybe early adulthood, something very impactful happened and it just set them on this course. And no matter how many times they tried to deviate and become, you know, part of the regular structure, it just never, you know, it doesn't work out that way. It you can meld them. You and I both have done that. You know, we both had lives in the everyday world and were successful, and then now put all of our sights on this stuff. But it's important that people understand the backstory, because it is, to me, it's kind of validating that we come in with an agenda of work to do. And, you know, and then we come in with a group. We never come in as one person just, I'm going to take off and save the world, you know, or or give the world information.
I can't do it. I'm one little guy.
Why would you want to? But there's always a story there about how you were given the information and then what you did with it, because it niggles at you, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah.
You were a little child and heard these things. And, you know, we were speaking off record about my own dad, you know, who never would speak about anything that he did. And, you know, at first blush, it just looked like he had a regular job in the military and he had a regular job in the Justice Department. But he would, you know, give little pieces of information about where he had been for weeks at a time, supposedly doing drills or something, you know, when I was a little bitty kid. And I remember, you know, it's Edwards Air Force Base and Roswell and White Sands and, you know, all of these places, and it sticks in your mind. And I don't know why it did, because, you know, most of the time he talked about the rose garden out back or washing and waxing the new car, or, you know.
Yes. My mom was the same way.
It has a purpose. Yeah. Right?
So, Chamber of Commerce, and she'd be, you know, it was that all that stuff. But no, that kept on niggling at me through the years, and it would get my mom angry sometimes. I would, you know, I remember one point, I was probably in my late 20s, and I was trying to get more. I just wanted more information from her. She comes walking into the living room. Kitchen was next room over, probably going to the kitchen. But I was sitting there in the easy chair, and I look up at her, and I'd been pondering all this stuff all morning, yet again, over the years. And I just looked at her. I said, Mom, tell me just a little bit more about when you were working in the city under the desert. Just a little bit. Please, please, just anything more. Because, you know, you just kind of put the bug there, and she's like looking at me with the eyebrow raised and shaking her head. Didn't say anything. She turned around and she starts walking the other direction down the hallway. And I watched her, and she stopped walking. And she was standing there for a second. She turned back around. She comes back over and she said, I'll tell you one more thing. And she had sort of a wicked half grin. I can't even do it.
Oh, boy.
She said, you were there. And I said, what do you mean I was there? And she said, son, when I was working in the little city under the desert, I was pregnant with you. You were in my tummy, is what she said.
Oh, my goodness.
So technically, you were there, too. And she smiles. And she turns around, and it's exit stage left.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Your mom was... She was just a card.
I know. So that's the kind of stuff, you know, it would just be little bits more I would hear. When she was on her deathbed, I thought maybe I would get the... But no, you know, I mean, she held firm to what she had told me. I had one friend who is a skeptic. I'm still friends with him. He didn't believe there was anything to the UFO phenomena, and he didn't believe in underground bases and stuff, which, sure. You know... Or whatever, you know. And it was frustrating me. So I just thought, why not, you know, let's try. I grab him by the shoulder. It's like I pushed him over to my mom, who is now like in her hospital bed in the living room. You know, she was, you know, yeah. Sadly dying of cancer, which finally took her a few months after. When I asked her, I said, you know what, Mom, Ken doesn't believe that you worked in an underground base, the city under the desert. and he's acting like you're lying or I'm lying, and like maybe set him straight there, please. And she puts her glasses down like this, and she looks up. You know, she's doing her shorthand notes, probably with Lockheed again, because she kept working as a private headhunter for these guys.
Wow.
She looks at him and she says, well, how the hell do you think that we hide our national secrets, Ken? She said, "But where would you hide anything that was sensitive to national security?" And she said, of course, we have deep underground military bases. And yes, I did work in one, and Earl is not lying to you. Any more questions? I know. Now, this guy is still around, and I thought, you know, well, maybe, you know, if anybody ever has any question about my mother's story, I can always bring him, because he doesn't he still doesn't believe in UFOs. But he heard this, and he heard it from my mom's mouth, and he knew, and he knows. He
wouldn't lie.
Yeah, my mom was like, you know, she was sending people out to Ben Risch, Lockheed, and you know, she was definitely, you know, she was connected, and this is what she did till the day she died. So, that was my mom, you know.
Love it.
I don't know if she would be horrified or thrilled with what I'm doing right now, because I'm technically telling everybody all the stuff that she spent her life protecting, you know, and keeping.
I can tell you she's thrilled because she wanted to tell the world. And she,
I think she did.
Now she can, because it's okay.
I didn't sign anything, you know.
You know what's funny, Earl? Maybe
I'm still getting over that silly flu, by the way. Sorry about that.
Oh, no.
We had it for
2 weeks, too. Something that just came to mind, although, you know, absolutely no pressure, but it just came to mind. I never knew she was pregnant with you when she worked down there.
Yeah.
Maybe, you know, if you're ever up for it, I'll do a quantum hypnosis session with you. And because if you're there, you're experiencing.
Sure.
We know.
Name a date. I'm there. I'm curious.
Oh, I would love to do it. My God, it would be maybe a huge case. I just know from my own motherhood, from the time I knew I had conceived, I was teaching and talking and doing things with my boys, you know, in utero. And it was very evident that they absorbed that stuff, you know, when they were wee babies and toddlers. They, you know, reading at age 1 and doing math you know, at 2 and
that's like that, as a heavy reader, you know, like the earliest memories are just, you know, my nose in a book. It's like was right there. So I don't know if they did something to me or if it's just I honestly don't know. I try not to go there. I'm not, you know,
even if you had no contact with ET beings or other worldly beings down there, you picked up on, you know, your energy field
absorbs. We absorb that.
It records everything.
Yes.
So you literally, you know, you're up Periscope the whole time. You could probably describe everything, you know.
Maybe.
Because they just have a, you know, an open pineal gland and
yes. I, you know, there were just so many moments in my life where it seemed there was another hand there. You know, I mean, miraculously, my life is not my own, because, I mean, one of the other earliest memories is a car accident that we had where I was thrown out of the car into a field. The car was upside down. This was when I was 3 years old as well, okay?
Oh my God.
3 years old. And my last memory is, you know, I remember my dad going, my dad was sitting next to me, my mom was driving, and my dad is going, Jesus will save us, Jesus will save us. And we're flying in the air, you know,
and
this, you know, oh my God, this flying car. And I remember seeing the blue sky and the white fluffy clouds. And it was almost like I was being pulled up. The next memory I have, our car was upside down. The wheels were spinning, right? It was mom went off an embankment because a bus threw a bunch of dust at us.
Yeah.
She thought she was going into the shoulder. There wasn't a shoulder. It was like
an embankment,
like a 30-foot embankment. So I was thrown out of the car, they said, somehow, but they still don't know how. The window apparently was, you know, closed most of the way. But I remember going, I remember the blue sky and the white clouds. They found me lying face up. I was looking at the wheels of the station wagon spinning around. There was a boulder this far away from my head. I didn't have a scratch on me. My mom broke her back. My dad had a scratch. A scratch. But mom's back was broken. She had, you know, she was in the hospital for a while. And dad would take me out there. I'd sing Jesus Loves You to her from, they wouldn't let the kids in the hospital in those days. But there's so many stories like that. Another one when I was maybe about 8 or 9 years old at Catalina Island with my dad, running up ahead of our little group, and there were these bushes, and I was just running, you know, I was having fun, and somehow or another I stopped running suddenly, and I looked down, and there is like a 200 foot cliff in front of me. It was the trail, you know, and I was going off the trail, but I feel like, you know, somehow or another I've been protected. I've been kept safe, and maybe that's so that I can do and say the things I'm doing now, because we are disclosure.
We are.
Government is not disclosure. They're the wrong gatekeepers for this, in my opinion.
No.
You know, the officialdom is all about threat assessment and how can we weaponize this?
And exploitation of
yes.
Right?
You know, I mean, that's not exactly the best diplomats to be dealing with star visitors. Do you think
why would you believe? I ask people this all the time. Why are you pushing for it when, in the first place, why would you believe someone who has lied blatantly to you and
77 years or
for all, well, yeah, for all these years, and then, you know, where's the disconnect there? So I just don't, I don't even concern myself much with it. I keep my hand in it just
because. I do. I belong to the Hollywood Disclosure, you know, alliance.
You have to. You know. Exactly. You have to.
But I believe we are disclosure, though. I think that we are the disclosure and that we must do due diligence and tell people what we know. I'm very careful with anything that might be construed as a national security issue. I mean, I bump into cases where I think this sounds like us. This doesn't.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
and I'll keep those cases to myself if I think that, you know, I don't want to, you know, be a burr in the military's, you know what, you know. So I'm very careful about that. But I do believe that humanity has a need to know.
I do too, Earl.
That for us to get the risk that we have become to ourselves with nuclear weapons, the divisiveness that's there amongst people and political and religious groups and all that, it's like this thing that's ready to explode. And I think that this is the remedy. I think that we will behave better if we know that we are not alone, that we are being observed and worried about.
Yeah.
And we have two choices. We can become Star Wars or Star Trek. Yes. I believe that the whole Star Wars thing is a human thing. It's a human mentality. Mm-hmm. It's us supinating and mirroring on the cosmos our own problems. But I don't see that threat coming from out there. I see that threat as something that's here, that's ingrown, and that's homegrown.
It festers into everything we do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, look at from babyhood on, our children are gratefully, like the parents are like delighted when little Tommy wants to play, you know, cowboys and Indians or get his little green army men out and have wars. And, you know, it's not just boys, it's girls too.
Yeah.
All this divisiveness, you know, it's just this ingrained programming that keeps getting passed down by the most benevolent of people. They don't even realize how detrimental it really is. But I agree with you, and again, it's something that the teachers have said, and it's something that all of our greatest thought leaders and avatars have said throughout the ages. It's the one thing that we have to get past to evolve, to become happy, to have a good world, to have a paradise like this world was meant to be.
Yes.
And that is to stop the divisiveness. We have to learn to live and work harmoniously. We all
How
have
can
special
we
gifts, you know?
Expect to get along with aliens, okay, that might look like a praying mantis, right?
Exactly.
If we're like hateful at each other because we have a different skin tone
color.
Or we have a different philosophy or
different
religious, yes.
Somebody wears a special hat, you know, my God.
Yeah.
It's
the
so
things
relevant.
That should make us special to each other are the things that divide us. The cultural differences
sad?
Of foods, the mm-hmm. pageantry and everything that's in every single culture, that enriches us and that can make us a better and stronger and sweeter species.
It absolutely
but
can.
Instead, we take up weaponry against each other over the smallest differences.
That's a crazy default. It's worse now than ever. But
it
I
is.
I do have it on good authority. I mean, I really do. And I believe this to the depth of my heart that this is the time that it happens. And, you know, we feel it happening. We feel it coming to a head. You know, I've often said this is a gross analogy, but it's like a gigantic pimple on the end of your nose when you're a teenager. And it's just huge and it's gross and it's painful and it's ugly. But one day it bursts and the ugliness oozes out. And it's very painful when that happens and you want to hide. You know, you don't want to be engaging with others and all that, but then it starts to heal and the new skin comes. That's what's happening here.
I agree.
The old world must fall away. These old constructs must fall away and fail before we can. I think humans, it's just human nature that we have to almost come up against the edge of the cliff before we decide to help each other not fall over.
See what you did there. Yeah.
It's a great story.
You know, okay, the three things that people hear from our visitors, you know what they are.
No, I do know. What, I've been told
it's a trifecta of telepathic messages that people are left with. It doesn't matter what the case, whether it was, you know, seemingly malign or seemingly benevolent. They could appear as space brothers. They could appear as the little gray guys that are, you know, non-reactive and have a job to do, or, you know, some
the gorts of the universe.
Some people, you know, yes, the gort. Yeah. Okay, no Captain Kirk to punch him in the nose, you know. but the three things that people hear, and we've especially in MUFON's experience or resource team, we notate this and we notice it from case to case to case to case. Everybody is told war is wrong. Nuclear war will destroy you. There's no way to survive it. So don't try it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's number one. Number two is stop treating your Earth like it's disposable or replaceable. Yeah. It's not. Stop trashing your world. And number three, better yourselves. Elevate your vibration. Your frequency is too low. And now, so many of us, we hear that, you know, frequency, vibration, you know, Dr. Medich and I, you know, he's the head of the ERT, you know.
Yeah.
We're noticing this phrase coming up over and over again from all these diverse sources, scientists and military and, you know, Joe, you know, trash collector, right? Doesn't matter. Same things, you know, what does it mean to raise your vibration? And, but, you know, it's technically better yourself. Stop having yourself as the most important thing, you know, in the universe and treating the world and everybody else like it's your enemy that you have to overcome. And
comes from fear.
It is fear-based, and fear is a lie. I studied the Bible, you know, the New Testament and the original Koine Greek when I was young.
Mm-hmm.
And fear, you know, it's very definitive what fear is regarded. It says God has not given you the spirit of fear, And you'll see that in every philosophy. You'll see that in other, you know, fear is where fight and flight originates from.
Right.
It's where, and that's our problem, is we want to run or we want to kill. You know, that's our first reaction to anything that's new or could possibly be a threat. It comes from when we used to swing around in the trees, you know, but it's still there. And we seem to be, you know, moving and motivated out of that sort of fight or flight kind of core mentality. Right. And the only way to get past that is to raise our vibration, is to better ourselves, to live on a higher frequency where it isn't fear-based, where it isn't self-absorbed, and where there's care and empathy for others in the world.
Service to others instead of service to self. It's the work I do every day with my own clients, even to get them to go in and perceive clearly what it is they're trying to remember or to heal something. It's always the same message, raise the vibrational state. And so we do certain practices. It depends on the person. There are a million ways.
Meditating helps. Prayer helps.
Meditation, prayer, breath work.
Yeah.
You know, yoga, tai chi, service to others, being in
service
nature.
To others is a big one.
It's the big one.
Look at a soup kitchen, you know, it just like once a month or something to where you're, you know, giving without expecting something.
Anything. Do something unconditional. Go out, you know, if you're going for a hike, take a trash bag and a grabber and pick up the trash along the way. You know, it doesn't take a lot. But when you do something even as simple as that, or even come down to the bare minimum, smiling and complimenting the cashier who is working herself to death for nothing at the drive-through, you know? That might be the only nice thing that person's heard all week, and it may totally catapult her into some other, you know, place in her heart where she was destitute. I've seen it time and time again. But raising the vibrational state is key. It is the main message. And taking care of each other and the earth, you know.
Ripples become waves. We as human beings can create these ripples out there. Just one kind act, just one selfless act. And that it pays forward almost on its own volition. It's a thing that is contagious, and that's the thing that I think that can, you know, raise our vibration, our frequency, is by creating those little ripples. They become waves. I see it. I see it every single day. I see it in my little MUFON community here. You know, it started out with just a dream and a few people, and it's become this beautiful, beautiful group of real world friends that care about each other. It's not a meeting, you know, so much as it's almost like, I mean, I don't want to use the word church because it's not.
No,
you know, we're all different politically. We're all different. We come from our various backgrounds, but there's this this camaraderie and this
community.
It's community, and I think that's an important thing for us to create out there.
Well, it's how we
and you do that one on one, and it coalesces and coheses and becomes something great.
It does. And that's again, part of the work I do. And I know it's part of the work you do. Once I start working with these people, then I try to get them together in groups, you know, because that group energy is so powerful.
Yes.
But so having spoken about this, do you have any special cases or people stories that you'd like to punctuate this conversation with so that people can really get a flavor for what you do and what you offer at MUFON? Because, you know, people have a stigma about MUFON in some of the contact community and in the outer community too, you know, who don't have anything to do with it. What can you give us today that might kind of underscore some of this?
Sure. Well, you know, MUFON, we started and still are primarily a research group, right? That was, you know, the basis that MUFON was based on. It's the scientific study of UFOs for the benefit of humanity. Although it has that benefit of humanity thing in there. It's not the scientific study of UFOs to, you know, have better weaponry or, you know.
Yeah.
So I think that, you know, that in its essence was a really, really beautiful flashpoint for this organization to grow up from.
Well, didn't
like any large organization.
I'm sorry. kind of take over after Project Blue Book supposedly closed down.
Mm-hmm. And there was a bumper sticker.
It's a grassroots movement.
Yes.
Not government.
No, it's not.
Attached.
We're all volunteers. No, the only people that are paid are you know, the director of MUFON, office personnel, and I think that maybe our IT guys are part-time basis. Yeah, they clock in and out. It's not you know, like a salaried job. But at the core, we're all volunteers. We are in here for the love of the phenomena. We want to understand the phenomena. We want to adhere to scientific methods as closely as possible, even though the scientific method doesn't really work because you can't repeat an experiment, you know. That's
it's third-dimensional science when we're dealing with mostly non-third-dimensional.
It is. But MUFON is a huge and sprawling organization. There are hundreds and hundreds of members and different state directors and people. And we do not tell everybody, this is what you believe, this is your philosophy, and this is what. Now, in some ways, that could be a problem back when you'd have, say, an experiencer come to MUFON. And you might get a state director or somebody that didn't think that ET abduction or visitation happened very often or at all.
Sure.
And this was the reason why Kathleen Martin and George Medich, Denise Stoner, the core people, Dr. Dondery, who started the ERT, this was the reason why. So that no matter where you were, if you were an experiencer and you had a contact episode where you were visited by entities or taken by entities, whether malign or seemingly benevolent, or you could go and you could get a hold of an ERT member and you could go and report your case, your incident, your visitation or whatever it was specifically, and have people who are aware that this is a real thing, that are trained. We have psychologists, doctors, scientists. Every single person in this group knows that this is a very real and active phenomenon.
Yeah.
And you can go there and you will get resources, help. They can send you to a support meeting where there's many of those. I'm going to be starting one of my own soon, on Zoom. If you have a burning desire to be hypnotically regressed as in through the quantum method, I love Dolores Cannon, love the way that she, quantum healing, regression is an amazing thing. Yeah, I know Kathleen Martin uses that method. We have the resources to, put people in touch with good folks like yourself. Mm-hmm. Who can privately do this for them. And also, I mean, I have so many people that were originally cases, right, that came in through the ERT, where I've known them years now, because you wind up being friends. You wind up kind of being a mentor to a lot of these folks who I know for myself, because I had... And we only have so much time to talk here today. But I had my own experience back when I first started poking at the phenomena. I found out the phenomena pokes back, right?
Yes, it does.
So
be careful what you wish for, right?
Yes. And I didn't really know where to go. Now, I drove 200 miles to my state director here to talk with him about it. And it confused him. He was looking at me kind of sideways, because the last thing he wanted to hear was his new field investigator had been visited by aliens, you know. But thank God I looked around a little bit, and I finally got a hold of Kathleen Martin, and I met with her for lunch. I know. Oh my God. God bless her. And she was so helpful. I mean, she didn't tell me what to think. She didn't tell me what to believe. She didn't tell me, but she let me know that I wasn't the only person who'd gone through this. mm-hmm. that it differs from people and differs between beings, and there apparently are, you know, varying motives out there, just like there right. would be with you know, humans. Yeah, you know, we're not all the same, and we don't have all the same motives. But it was the most helpful thing in the world. After about an hour of speaking with Kathleen and just really having my fears allayed and feeling much, much better about everything, I told Kathy, I said, you know, I might want to be like a member of the ERT myself. How does one get interviewed for such a thing? And she said, well, what do you think we've been doing the last hour? Welcome to the ERT.
I love it.
You know, I was pretty much, I mean, I still had to be mentored in through.
Of course.
There's a mentoring process, and it's not like you can learn this stuff in school, you know. So they kind of have their own system set up, and Kathleen and good people like Sevtok and Castle, and we've got our team of experts, you know, many of which worked at the Monroe Institute and places like this, and mm-hmm. and people are not alone out there. So if you've had an experience, you can get a hold of me, and I'm easy to get a hold of. I'll even dox myself. My email is earlgreyanderson@gmail.com. You know,
we'll put that in the video too. So.
Yeah, I pretty much let people use that. That's my email. That's primarily just for this sort of thing. You can go to MUFON.com. where it says report a UFO. Next to it, there's a button that says report an entity or an abduction. If you click that button, you'll get a good person that is knowledgeable about this phenomenon, who will help you. Doesn't have an agenda except to help you. We're there to serve. We're there as a resource. I'm proud of that.
I love it so much. I can tell you from a personal experience in 2011, now, you know, I've had contact my whole life, but in 2011, I had one of the most spectacular contacts, along with about 200 other people. And it was incredible. You know, first it was personal with my little part of my family, and then there was a group of people because it was Halloween night. But it was so special because I, with my little iPhone 5, captured video of the phenomenon. And so as soon as I got home, it was about midnight, I thought, you know what, this is something, I've never done this before, I'm going to send it to MUFON. And I sent it to our local MUFON chapter in Kansas City. And immediately, like the next morning, I got a call from our local director, Margie Kay, and she interviewed me right then. Like, it was like a two-hour interview. And
Margie's great.
over the course of many weeks, we talked back and forth, and it eventually was presented on Coast to Coast by Linda Moulton Howell and Debbie Ziegelmeyer as a very special case. And I thought, wow, it's incredible, because I'm just one person, and I just sent a couple of files and a short description at midnight one night, and that's all I sent. And I was flooded with support from people I never knew. I know her very well now, we're good friends, but I you know, but it was just incredible and it's all volunteer.
Yep.
You know, and so much care went into that, and they resourced those videos as tiny as they were, and they sent them off to be tested and everything, and they really validated that what I
Wonderful.
Got was nothing man-made. So I have to commendate you on this. I mean, I can't express to people, this is all volunteer. These are just people who care. They're not in it for anything but to help. And that is kind of what do they call it? Homo novus? It's what the new human is about. It's what the new earth is about.
Yeah, I agree. You know, I just feel blessed that I get to do what I'm doing, and that there's a framework set for this.
It's helpful.
And there's openness with people. You know, sometimes people think of MUFON as this immovable edifice and it's not that. It's made of people. It's made of people with personalities, with emotions, and I've seen MUFON change for the better. You know, everything and everyone is in flux. It's either we're that or you're involved. Dead, right? You know, and even then you're probably in flux. We just don't see it.
Always, yeah.
Yes. But, you know, it's the same thing. And I know that MUFON being like the big edifice on the corner, right? It's like the big church. It's been there for all these years. And like any organization, there have been good times, there have been bad times, you know, it's had its scandals in the past and it's in its glories but it's just an organization. It's a gathering of people who have one thing in common, and that is that we want to understand this phenomenon. We want to know the truth, and it's important that people in the world know that we're not alone. It's very simple. I mean, you know, and like you were saying, it's like Project Blue Book closed their doors and MUFON opened theirs. And that, I don't Perfect. Believe, was any coincidence. There was a bumper sticker available for a while that I think we should reprint. It said, MUFON, doing the Air Force's job since 1969.
Yes.
With this recent era.
Actually, that's right.
I mean, it's ever even more so evident that this is the case.
It is.
So it's good that there's an organization like that. Like the big church on the corner, you get graffitiized and people throw stuff at it. You know, people, you know, I don't know. There seems to be something in human nature where you bring a star up and then you just tear them down. Public, right?
But walk inside and you have a completely different experience.
Yes, right? Exactly.
How many times?
And MUFON is what you make it, folks.
It is.
I mean, I saw things that I wanted to do here. I wanted it to be just this inviting group where everybody's respected, your views are respected. Politics are not an issue. Your religion isn't an issue. Your ethnicity is not an issue. Your background is not an issue. You are there as a human, and we are gathering together, you know, under MUFON's precept, the scientific study of UFOs for the benefit of humanity.
And it helps so many people. It helps so many mm-hmm. people. You know, you have thousands of cases that you've worked with, but I know that you have some really special ones, and you have one really special one that you're going to start presenting really at the symposium.
Right? Talking about the Jackrabbit case,
yeah,
right?
I mean,
recently on the UAP study podcast talking about this very important case.
Yeah.
And it's an ERT case.
Important cases I've ever worked on, too. It's just... Mm-hmm. One of the most unique and beautiful.
Yes, it is. Isn't it wild how it's like the right people, and none of us were connected at the beginning, right? This just like we were all working in our own little arenas.
Niches, right.
But it was all the right people. It was you, Preston Dennett. It was myself. It was Richard Banaszak, who's my local field investigator. With a background as a police detective.
Yeah, an amazing person.
This case, when it came in, we're reading the case report, you know, the witness testimony that we get, and it's talking about these two women that had gotten out of the Navy, decided to take a cross-country trip, and they were in Utah, I believe. Was it Utah?
I think it was Utah, yeah.
Where it was the middle of the night, and the road was occluded by jackrabbits. So they weren't going to run over the jackrabbits. They were 3.5 feet to 4 foot tall, which doesn't exist, okay?
Yeah.
It's no such thing. But this was real enough, and these women were not on any substance. They were, you know, just honorably discharged.
Driving out the desert,
driving to visit their family across country. They stop the car, and the witnesses get out, and they're surveying this impossibility that's going on in front of them. You know, it's so abstract and so absurd. And I love that. I think that the phenomena has a sense of absurdist humor to it.
Yeah, delightful.
It does. It's almost like an eye wink.
Yeah.
So they're looking at this, and suddenly God's own spotlight comes down from outer space. Mm-hmm. They're suddenly in the spotlight, perfectly silent. It was so bright they couldn't quite see the object, although it was roughly saucer-shaped, like two mm-hmm. saucers put together, you know, the classic mm-hmm. movie flying saucer. The rabbits all turn at once, very dramatic, and we see this in cases. Our visitors have a sense of drama, they have a sense of humor.
Impact.
Yes, the impact was impeccable. Yes. The black eyes are seen, they were the little gray characters that we mm-hmm. see ubiquitously from case to case to case, mm-hmm. seem to be the worker bees of phenomenology.
Right.
And the next thing these women know is that they are being taken up into the air, into this craft. Now, it was hours later, I think it was over 4 hours later, that they find themselves coming to, like they were under some kind of a trance, coming to in a diner that is now halfway across the country,
like 400
miles away.
Or something, right?
Yeah, Grand Junction. Yeah. It was, and the mileage did not show up on their odometer. The women had what appeared to be some side effects of radiation that they were dealing with, some burns, and there were some strange medical things that happened with the main witness, a missing ovary, for instance, yeah. that happened after this, that was noticed by her practitioner,
ruptured appendix, even.
Yes, a healed ruptured appendix.
Goodness.
Where it appeared like a laser had been used to seal what could have caused sepsis in this poor woman. It could have caused blood poison for her. Yes. Well, all of this apparently happened on this, you know, what was initiated as the jackrabbits. And of course, you know, we know about screen memories. Mike yes. Cleland talks about the owls that people
Absolutely.
See. Mm-hmm. They're 4 foot tall. Yeah. People report children will have visitation anomalously, and it'll be their favorite cartoon character or a chessboard character will start speaking. Mm-hmm. to them. That's what I had happen
yes.
when I was
yes
my chessboard piece started speaking to me intelligently, you know, and it was the king and the queen, you know, having a tete-a-tete, and they were talking, you know. Maybe. so they use screen memories. I believe that all of us who have had contact later in life, we've had probably had contact earlier in life. Really? It's an ongoing thing. And anyway, we're proud to be presenting this case at the MUFON Symposium. Both witnesses are going to be there. Richard, who is my police detective, and when the case came in, I immediately said, "There's a marker there, a marker there, a marker. This is a real. I'm taking this very seriously. Rabbits be damned. This is a serious case, you know." And I notice with all the good cases, there seems to be an intentional bit of absurdity thrown in there.
Yeah.
It's almost like a business card or a signature of
I call it
phenomenon.
A post-it note.
Yeah.
So that they'll remember. It's so yes. shocking, right?
Yes. It's us again. Hello. I decided to give it to Richard because I figured, well, Richard is very, very good. He's an ERT member, but he's also a very, like a skeptical field investigator. If it was a drone that somebody saw, or if it was a SpaceX or a plane or whatever, we want to delineate from real UFOs. And you have to do that. And that makes people angry. That's given MUFON kind of a bad name among some groups, but we have to do that. If you want real UFOs, we have to figure out what's a plane, what's a blimp, and what's a mothership, you know?
Right.
So I knew he could do this. I knew he would be honest. I knew he would be compassionate and fair with the witness, because that's just Richard's nature. He calls himself, he says that he, as he worked as a police detective, that he was a public servant for 35 years doing this. And that's his attitude.
Yeah.
He did a marvelous job. He did such a beautiful job on that case that MUFON apparently is awarding a case of interest of the year.
Fantastic. And I agree. It's just so unique. And it has all of the pieces that we want. It's really kind of a perfect template, isn't it, for what you're looking for. If somebody comes to you, do they have these aspects? You know, not the specific variables, but do they have these aspects? If they do, it's really important that you dig deep.
Yes.
And having him work on that as the investigator, I think, made all the difference in the world. He's
yep.
the most methodical, you know, leave.
All the right people were in this.
Yeah.
We had the therapist over here. Yeah. We had Preston, the journalist, serious, wonderful, excellent journalist and investigatory journalist, 35 books under his belt now. Yeah. We had the police detective. And I was there just more or less as kind of mentor overseer with Richard. And also I was in contact with the witness. Mm-hmm. But that was after the case was already closed.
Yeah.
We met, the witness and I met on social media because I was talking about her case.
I remember
on a podcast.
On a podcast.
And I redacted all the names, redacted names, places, you know, because I pretty
like
much adhere
today.
To HIPAA law, you know, standards with that.
Right.
It's not up to me to, you know,
we don't
dox somebody else, right?
Right.
And get their name out there. But she messaged me and said, hey, you.
Wasn't she in the chat on the podcast?
Yeah, so she said,
like, that's me,
you know, and so we met, and a lovely woman and just so down to earth, but yet feet on the ground, head in the stars. This phenomena changes people for the better. She's an example A, you know, changes people.
I'm so happy. I am so happy to hear it's going to be a, you know, premiered at this very prestigious symposium.
Yes.
And thank you for all the work you do. Is there anything else you want to say about your own experiences or others that stand out before we go? Because I know people, we could talk for hours, but I know that you're busy, but I know people are probably just riveted by now by what you're saying.
There's a lot. It seems like our visitors are very, very interested in the military. And I think that it's more, maybe they're confused with this aspect about humanity, how we can be compassionate and then we can go and do a war, you know, which is kind of like mass murder. It may be for a good cause, but we're killing each other. But then again, these same creatures will go and they will risk their lives for a book or for poetry or for
to
keep
dolphins.
Somebody else safe, you know, so or dolphins or and I think that's kind of it is a strange aspect, our duality aspects of our nature, but I notice a lot of cases where military people will be taken up and almost watched for their reactions. One Marine gentleman back in the 1960s was taken up through the roof of Camp Pendleton, and he was treated kind of aggressively by his ETs. They showed him disastrous things that could happen on Earth, and they were looking for, I think, a warlike reaction, which he gave them initially. Initially, he wanted to strangle him. He was trying But eventually he started praying. Okay. Eventually he started realizing the greater implications of this. And he started praying and thinking about humanity, thinking benevolent stuff. And that was when they brought him back down into his barracks. He had been missing. His bunkmate thought he had gone AWOL or something. Well, there he is, like fetal position in the middle of the barracks, and his life was changed. Now, after this initial shock and awe type of meeting he had with his entities, it became very much like a teacher-student situation. Yeah. He would find himself having a dream that was realer than a dream, where he was flying a blue sphere over the Navy Yards of San Diego, you know. He was, and it was all like this, kind of like handing him the keys to the kingdom and mm-hmm. Someday you can become like us. This is mm-hmm. what your potentialities are here.
Love it.
Another guy, a Navy gentleman who was on an aircraft carrier, middle of the Pacific between Japan and the Philippines. And on his 21st birthday, he was taken up through the deck, and he felt every single deck, like physically, he could feel it in his body. It wasn't like out-of-body experience, where he was taken up into low Earth orbit. There was no craft there waiting for him. It was two mm-hmm. beings that were in the shape of a human, but were pure light.
Yeah.
And again, they show him the Pacific Rim volcanoes going off. They show what, you know, the way the future could be, you know. Mm-hmm. It's sort of like Christmas Carol, you know, where
yes.
this is what could happen. This is what could happen.
The
you got to change.
Christmas past, you know? And present and future, yeah.
Again, they waited for his reaction, and his reaction was immediately very much so one of concern, one of empathy for humanity, one of sadness for yes. humanity and loss. He said that he felt overwhelmed and enveloped by the deepest love that he had ever felt in his life.
Yeah.
He said that it felt like your mother and your father and your family all at once, but it was completely encompassing him. And he was taken back down to his bunk, to his rack in the yeah. aircraft carrier. Happy birthday. And these are the kind yeah. of experiences that people have. They're transformative.
Yes.
And I think they're as much trying to learn about us as they're trying to teach us about them and trying to teach us about where we need to go to become a spacefaring race ourselves. Become space worthy. Star Trek, not Star Wars, you know.
Amen. Amen, man.
I think would be the best classic examples I have to give you. I have many, many more just like that, though.
I love it.
It's amazing.
I have too. I mean, I just every day. It's
yep.
like every day we get another person. And I work with, you know, normal everyday people, but mm-hmm. I also work with a lot of people who aren't ever allowed to speak about any of this stuff, but have yeah. nobody else to speak to it about, or people who have, you know, gone through, like your mom, who signed all the papers,
yep,
and they're so old now that they don't care. They're yeah. like, okay, my family's okay. They're not. They can't be harmed. I can't be harmed. I'm on my deathbed, but I want to tell somebody and I want to understand, because they still yeah. have missing pieces, and I think it's such an honor to be able to work with these people.
Yes, it
whether
is.
They're just they feel funny and they don't know why, to the person who has these outlandish experiences and they just feel like they want to tell someone before they leave the planet because they know
yes.
how important it is. But in between, there's this huge contingency of people who have received this information, whether it's been, you know, seated in front of screens that show what might possibly happen, or, you know, the secret school is Whitley Street.
Yeah.
What I went through when I was a kid.
Sev talk. She went through something
Sev
like that.
Too. Absolutely. Yeah. And
I had one cop who was abducted from his cruiser, was how
yes.
it started while on duty. And at night he started having these very, very, very realistic dreams. And it was repeating every single night. It was like, we're starting the reel now.
Yeah.
Where he'd see this little diminutive hand, a gray hand with four fingers, holding one of those little lecture batons, right? Pointing to mathematical equations on a blackboard. Now, this guy was a D-minus math student. He said, it's just ironic that they would pick me to give this information to. Went on for a month. At the end of the month, gets a little, his instructor shows up finally, you know, and it's
yeah.
kind of a proverbial tall gray alien, and says, now you're going to forget everything that I've taught you, but it will come back when it is needed in the right time.
Exactly.
And this police officer believed that it was zero-point energy information he was being given. So people are getting downloads. They're being
timed.
It's very strange. It doesn't seem, it sure doesn't seem like an invasion to me, though.
No.
It seems like somebody's trying to help us survive ourselves.
Absolutely.
That's what I believe.
No, I do too. I think, you know, they're the midwives of what we're to become if we choose not to blow ourselves up or annihilate each other.
Yeah. Let's hope. Yeah. Let's pray.
There are babysitters.
Be positive.
Yeah. But, you know, it takes people like you to bring it to the well, thank you. But to bring it to the human plateau where we can all meet together and have these conversations and know that it's not, it's nothing, you know, it seems so out of the ordinary, but it's not. It's part of our lives. It's in the tapestry of our life.
I don't think this is our visitor's first rodeo. I imagine that this is, you know, repeated on many, many, many worlds, and they probably have their successes and their failures, and they may have had failures here already, it
they
seems like.
Had.
Yeah, yeah, that's
They don't call them failures. They're just, you know, we're a do-over.
Yeah,
do-overs.
Do-over.
But they do say that we make it. And so that gives me great hope. That's
me too.
Why I'm still here.
Me too.
You know, I think I'm still here to be the cheerleader for everybody. I'm like, you guys were so close.
Yeah.
Let's drop all this other BS and get, you know, let's get to working together. Let's feed each other. Let's clothe each other. You know, let's love each other. Let's plant some trees, you know?
Yeah, heck yeah.
And really, that's what we need to do.
And ripples become waves. It may be like the smallest little act, but it'll snowball, and it may encourage somebody that is in power to do something magnificent. That
and I know that's happening.
I do
can
too.
Assure you it's happening. I can't say names, but it is happening. But
yes,
you know, you were saying ripples create waves. But waves sometimes create tsunamis, and tsunamis restructure the whole plateau.
Landscape.
So and that's what's happening. If we can just infuse that tsunami with love, we're golden.
Yes. Tsunami of love. I got a new song chorus there.
Tsunami of love.
I know. Sounds like, I don't know, Journey could come up with some.
Yeah.
Don't stop believing. Anyway.
Well, it'll be Earl's new song.
I don't know. We'll see.
Well, Earl, thank you. Is there anything else you would like to bestow upon the world right now? I mean, I'd
love
to have you on like another 100 times, but right now I think, you know, you've got other things.
I think we've pretty much gone the full circle, and it seems bookended, and I'm happy with what we got here. So
I am too.
It's a pleasure and a joy.
Thank
and
you.
I'm so glad we finally got to do this.
Me too. I know. People
and I'd love to come back anytime because you're a friend.
I would love
to. We're the same page. So
I would love to. And
thank God.
Congratulations. I just saw where you were named for KGRA as well.
The new host with Seth.
Show with
Seth Talk and myself.
Wow, that's super exciting. Yeah. That's going to really
MUFON Contact Radio. It sounds like the voice of God on the commercial.
Know.
You know, it's so funny. That was my I was saying, make it sound like God or ET.
Yeah.
You know? He got
the
it.
Voice
it was
from
so
the
funny.
Heavens.
I know.
I love it. I've only been on KGRA once,
and
but
accurate.
I loved it. And I'm so excited for you guys because the two of you together are like so magnetizing. It's going to be wonderful.
She's my spaces. That's what I call her, you know?
And she is. She's amazing.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Earl. I appreciate it so much. You're such a beautiful, beautiful soul. And
thank you, Debs.
You
too.
And thank you for all you're doing. And just, you know, for the audience, keep looking for all these hidden variables in your own world. There are people like Earl and Sev Talk and all these other people walking around right next to you. And it's probably even you. Just be the best person you can be.
Yes.
Raise the vibration yourself. It's viral. And then we'll take off. But Earl, thank you for being one of those beautiful hidden variables.
Thank you.
Love you to death. We appreciate you. And I will end by saying, in Lakesh, I am
in Lakesh.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ignorance and smile, be yourself, no matter what they say.